Come and dine. Come and eat spiritually. Time for spiritual food. Thank God for this beautiful Lord's Day morning. Beautiful Sunday in January. Take as many of those as we can get, won't we? Amen. Trust you had a good week, and thank the Lord for the privilege of being here. Would you stand with us for the reading of some scripture found in the 105th Psalm? This is a reference to when Israel came out of the land of Egypt that we'll be talking about later. Egypt was glad when they departed, for the fear of them fell upon them. He spread a cloud for a covering and fire to give light in the night. The people asked, and he brought quails and satisfied them with the bread of heaven. He opened the rock, and the water gushed out. They ran in the dry places like a river. For he remembered his holy promise and Abraham his servant, and he brought forth his people with joy and his chosen with gladness, and gave them the lands of the heathen, and they inherited the labor of the people, that they might observe his statutes and keep his laws. Praise ye the Lord. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the privilege of being in your house today. Thank you for everyone that has made the effort to be here this morning. Accept our expression of praise and worship today. We ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Be seated, Sister Ashley. Come. found him to meet every need. You don't need to be looking for something else today. We found it all, and we found Christ. Amen. All right, we want to go to the Lord again in prayer this morning. Let's remember those that are suffering today, and concerned with a friend who lost her husband because of COVID, and so much sadness today because of this disease that's rampant. Let's pray that God will somehow intervene and bring an end to this thing. Let's pray for our nation. We know that we're facing perilous times as a country, and let's pray that God will somehow turn our nation back to Him. Amen. Shall we stand together and join our hearts in prayer this morning? Father, again, we're grateful for the privilege to be in your house today. Thank you for the privilege of coming into your presence. You've asked us to come boldly to the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help us in time of need. And we're thankful that we can bring all of our needs to you today, knowing that you are abundantly able to meet them. We pray, dear God, that you would bless everyone in divine presence this morning. Be with those who may be struggling with issues in their life, and maybe there's physical problems or other situations, and the Lord, we just pray that you would give your grace and help and strength to any such person here this morning. And we pray, God, you would remember those that that are suffering today from this terrible pandemic that has hit our world. We just pray, God, that you would comfort and strengthen hearts that have lost loved ones, and just pray that you would draw them close to you and minister to their needs today. We pray, God, for our nation today that has been torn apart by turmoil and strife. We just ask, dear God, that somehow you would intervene. Help the leaders of our nation, Lord, to come back to the principles of God. We just pray for our country today that somehow you would help and intervene, Lord. We pray, God, that you would continue to help us as we worship you this morning. I pray that you would speak to us through your word, that you would draw us closer to you. Lord, we want to pray this morning also for the new pastor that will soon be coming. Just pray that you'd be with them in these busy days as they prepare to move, that you would give them each the need that they have, each need that they have, and that you would bring them safely and make them a real blessing, Lord. Continue to bless us and help us as we worship you. I pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. You may be seated. Take the holy offering.
I've been doing this over and over. need to stand?
Yeah.
My brain is on hold this morning. Oh, it's been, that's why I got off.
Instead of the lilies, they don't toil nor spin. And there's not a king with more splendor than him. Consider the sparrows, they don't plant nor sow, but they're fed by the master who watches them grow. We have a heaven, the Father above, with eyes full of mercy and a heart full of love. He really cares when your head is down low. Consider the lilies, and then you will know. May I introduce you to this friend of mine, who hangs out the stars, tells the sun when to shine, and kisses the flowers each morning with dew. But he's not too busy to care about you. We have a heavenly Father above, with eyes full of mercy and a heart full of love. He really cares when your head is down low. Consider the lilies, and then you will know. Just consider the lilies, and then you will know.
See the goodness and the greatness of God in nature, don't we? The song certainly speaks to that today. We worry so much about things, and yet God takes care of the little things in life. How much more is He going to watch out for His children? Amen. In Exodus chapter 31, we have an account of the children of Israel getting ready to leave the land of Egypt after God delivers them from 430 years of slavery. Exodus chapter 13, and I want to read verses 21 and 22. Exodus 13, 21 and 22. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of a cloud to lead them the way, and by night in a pillar of fire to give them light, to go by day and night. He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. Again, when the children of Israel were getting ready to leave Egypt after 430 years of slavery, you know the story of Moses and how God brought him back to Egypt and used the 10 plagues to convince Pharaoh to let the children of Israel go. God knew that they would need guidance and protection as they made their way from Egypt to the Promised Land, a distance of probably maybe 300 or 400 miles, depending on the route that that they took from Egypt to back to Israel or the Holy Land. And much of that was in the wilderness. Much of it was a long, tedious journey filled with obstacles. And God knew that Israel would need something to guard them on the way and something to guide them on the way. And so he provided this pillar of cloud by day. The Bible doesn't tell us how big that is, but you've seen huge mountainous clouds on a beautiful day. No doubt this cloud was a very bright, shining white cloud stationed there in the sky for all of Israel to see. And at night, the pillar of cloud became a pillar of fire so that they could see during the night if they needed to. And so God provided this pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire to lead and guide the children of Israel from the land of Egypt to the promised land. And we liken our Christian experience to that we are saved and we are delivered from the land of bondage, and God starts us off on a journey to the promised land, which is heaven. It's a way that we've not been before. As God told Israel, you haven't traveled this path before. There's will be a lot of new things on there. And so as we make our way from this world to heaven, we too, as God's children, need a guide and a guard. And God has provided such for us through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is to the church today and to us as individual Christians today what the cloud and the fire were to the children of Israel. What the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud did for the children of Israel on their journey to the promised land, the Holy Spirit has promised to do that for us today on our journey to God's promised land for us. And so the first thing we notice is that the cloud and the fire served as a guard and protection to the children of Israel. In Exodus chapter 14, we have the account of Israel getting ready to exit Egypt. You know the story, how that the plagues had come to Egypt. And the last plague, of course, was the death of the firstborn of every household that did not have the blood applied, and God gave Israel all the instructions for that. And even the palace, Pharaoh's firstborn, died that night, and Pharaoh allowed the children of Israel to leave the country. But in Exodus chapter 14, verses 19 and 20, the angel of God, which went before the camp of Israel, removed and went behind them. And the pillar of the cloud went from before their face and stood behind them. And it came between the camp of the Egyptians and the camp of Israel. And it was a cloud and darkness to them, Egypt. But it gave light by night to these, Israel, so that the one could not come near the other all the night. You know that Pharaoh's heart was softened by the death of his firstborn, and by the tragic death of all those in Egypt. But it wasn't very long. The children of Israel had just begun to exit Egypt when Pharaoh changed his mind. God hardened his heart, and it was brought to his attention that the children of Israel were leaving the land of Egypt. And so the Bible tells us that Pharaoh got his chariots together and his armies together, and he went back to Israel, to follow Israel. And in Exodus chapter 14, it tells us there of his effort to stop the children of Israel from leaving Egypt. And so God had already, it was night, and God had put the pillar of fire in the sky, and it was leading Israel out of Egypt. But when Pharaoh came up and started to follow them, and he was going to chase them down and bring them back, God moved the pillar of fire from in front of Israel and brought it back and put it between Egypt and Israel. This huge pillar of fire became an obstacle that stopped Pharaoh from following the children of Israel. And so God used the pillar of fire as a means of protection to Israel from being recaptured by Pharaoh. And God did not allow him to stop their exodus. And they got out of the country and they moved on to the Red Sea. And of course, you know the story. We won't recount all of that, how God finally and forever dealt with Pharaoh. But he used this pillar of fire as a guard to the children of Israel, as a protection to them. And Pharaoh was not able to keep them from leaving the land of Egypt and making their journey to the promised land. And so when we think about the church today, when we leave by the help and grace of God, when we leave the paths of sin and we quit following the devil and start serving God, we know that the devil is always going to try to get us back if he can. The Bible tells us in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 that we have an adversary. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, he identifies our adversary. Your adversary isn't your wife. Your adversary isn't your mother-in-law. Your adversary is not your in-law. Your adversary is not your in-laws. Your adversary is the devil. Now, sometimes he may use these people to get at you, but we're reminded here that as Christians, as children of God, we have an adversary, the devil, goeth about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so the devil is after each one of us today, but just as God brought protection to his children by the pillar of fire, the Holy Spirit brings protection to us from our enemy, the devil. The Holy Spirit guards us against the enemy of our soul. Isaiah chapter 59 and verse 19 says, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. And so when the devil attacks you and I, sometimes we're not aware of, I really believe that God probably has protected us from a lot of things that we don't know about. And maybe we'll discover that when we get to heaven. But we know the devil walks about seeking whom he may devour, and the Holy Spirit is our guard, it's our protection. And God brings the Holy Spirit in between us and the enemy of our soul. Isaiah goes up further to say, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When thou walkest through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon thee. And so God has promised us through the Holy Spirit protection from the enemy of our soul. We have a spiritual protection from the Holy Spirit. And it doesn't matter what we're passing through or what we're facing in life, we have the Holy Spirit as our guard, as our protection, and he comes to our help and to our aid. Just as surely as the pillar of fire stood between Egypt, the Egyptians, and Israel, the Holy Spirit stands between us and the enemy of our soul, and many times protects us from his plan and his purpose. Now, the Bible says here that even if we go through the fire, the flame shall not kindle upon thee. And that, of course, brings us to mind of the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they wouldn't bow down to the idol that had been erected, and they were commanded to worship that. And they were to worship God only. They were threatened that they would be thrown into the fiery furnace if they didn't bow down and worship. And they were given a second chance. They didn't need a second chance, but they got it. And they still would not bow down. And so the furnace was heated up seven times hotter than before. I don't know if they had a thermometer or what. Now they know that it was 7 times hotter than it had ever been before. How hot does it have to be to kill somebody? But they wanted to make sure they did away with those three Hebrew boys. Not only were they defying the command, but they wanted to wipe out any influence they might have on others. So they bound them. They got their strongest men to throw them in the fire. The devil always likes to make a big show of things. The fire 7 times hotter than before, and the strongest, biggest men in the kingdom to bind these three Hebrew boys. They probably didn't even resist. And it tells us there in the Bible when those men brought the boys to throw them into the fire was so hot that it consumed the men. And yet, when the fire cooled down and the king looked into the furnace, he saw the three Hebrew boys, and he scratched his head and said, "Well, wait a minute, didn't we put three in there, and I see four? And the fourth is likened unto the Son of God." And so God himself came down to be in the fire, and as hot as that fire was, I don't think the two Hebrew boys had to put out the flames on their own clothes even. They came out and didn't even have the smell of smoke on them. You talk about protection. God knows how to protect his own. And so we have the Holy Spirit to serve as our guard, as our protection, when the enemy of our soul comes in to defeat us and to try to get us to fall back. We have the Holy Spirit there as our guard, as our protection. And just as surely as the pillar of fire stood between the Egyptians and Israel, so the Holy Spirit stands between us and our enemy, and he gives us the victory and he protects us. I'm thankful this morning for the protection of the Holy Spirit. And again, not just physical protection, but spiritual protection. God keeps us from the plan and the purpose of the enemy. But not only were the cloud and the fire a guard for the children of Israel to protect them, they were a guide. They were to lead them. That God placed them in front of them. And the Bible says that God told Moses, when you see the cloud begin to move or the fire begin to move, then you break camp and you follow that. And when it stops, you stop. And as you study the wanderings of Israel, they were in the wilderness for 40 years. And so we know that they were guided a long time because that was their own fault. But we know that the cloud and the fire served as their guide. They were going on a journey they had never been on before through the wilderness, and that they needed someone not only to tell them where to go, but when to go. God is interested in every detail of our life, and his Holy Spirit wants to guide us and direct us not only where we should go, but his timing many times is important to us. And so the Holy Spirit is to the church what the cloud and the fire were to Israel. He is our guide. In John chapter 16, verse 13, Jesus says, "Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. He shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, then he shall speak, and he will show you things to come." And so as we read and study the early church, and especially in the book of Acts, we see how the Holy Spirit was the guide, the director of the early church. He directed people into the way that he wanted them to go. The hallmark of the early church, the distinguishing factor of the early church, was that they were led by the Holy Spirit. They were guided by the Holy Spirit. And as they followed the Holy Spirit, they were able to accomplish God's plan and God's purpose. And so it is today. The Holy Spirit is not only given to the church in general, but he is given to us personally to guide us, to guide me, to guide you into the way that God wants you to go. We all have a common destination, which is heaven. God is trying to get us all there, and he wants us to follow him. But your path to heaven may be a little different than my path to heaven. And the way that God wants you to go may be different than the direction that God wants me to go in our daily lives and so forth. And so we must be sensitive to the Holy Spirit, because he wants to lead us and guide us as individuals in the way that God wants us to go. And as you study the book of Acts, it was amazing how God directed the movements of the apostles and disciples of God as they followed him, so they could accomplish his purpose and his will. In Acts chapter 8, we have the story of Philip, who was an evangelist, a preacher. And he had gone down to the town of Samaria, and he was having a revival there in Samaria. A wonderful meeting where the whole city of Samaria was turning to God and repenting of their sins, and many people were following God. And I believe it was Samaria where the heathen and the devil worship was brought, all their books of black magic and all their things that they used in evil worship, and they burned them. And so Philip was having a tremendous revival. I don't know how many people were there, but it said the whole city, and Samaria was a pretty good sized town. So no doubt Philip was ministering to a lot of people. But then in Acts chapter 8, verse 26, it said the angel of the Lord spoke unto Philip, saying, arise and go toward the south and unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. God told Philip to leave this city revival, where many, many, no doubt hundreds of people were coming to the Lord, to leave there and to go down out into the desert, Gaza. And I don't know if Philip argued with the Lord, but I don't think he did. The Bible doesn't tell us he did. You know, when God told Jonah to go to Nineveh, he argued with God about it. But the Bible just tells us that in verse 27, he arose and went. It's always good to obey the Spirit. And when he tells you to do something, just do it. And so he went, and he got down into the desert, and nobody was there. And he probably was wondering, why did God ask me to leave this great revival where I was being successful and come down to the desert? I don't even see anybody. Wait a minute. I see some dust. And he stood there a while longer, and he noticed a chariot coming toward him. There was one man in that chariot. And, you know, if you remember the story there, this man was from Ethiopia. He was the treasurer of the queen of Ethiopia, a very valuable and important man in that country. And he had been to Jerusalem, and now was on the way home reading the book of Isaiah, and was wondering there the record of Jesus and how he suffered and so forth. And so Philip went up to the chariot, and the man stopped and invited him aboard, and God used Philip to introduce this man to Jesus, and this man believed on Christ. Now remember, they were out in the desert. God always just works things out the way he wants them to. Baptism was always a part of being saved. The Bible says that Peter said, repent and be baptized, and we were to follow the Lord in baptism. This man became a believer, and they came to the water in the desert. And he said, look, here's water, I can be baptized. And so he was baptized, and then Philip got out of the chariot. He didn't want to go to Ethiopia, so he got out of the chariot. The Ethiopian went on his way. Now here's Philip, out in the desert, by himself. I don't know how far away from where that was, but verse 39, when they were coming up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. God needed to get Philip back to some town And so the Spirit of the Lord just came and got him and carried him. Wow, what an experience. Have you ever been carried by the Spirit? Have you ever been in Overland Park and suddenly found yourself in Kansas City, Missouri? You wonder how you got there? No, you make your own way, don't you? But God used Philip, got this man saved, and that's how the gospel got into Ethiopia, that part of the world, through the conversion of this eunuch. And then God brought Philip back, and he continued his ministry. But I'm saying that to say the Holy Spirit was guiding. He was leading. Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, he will guide you into all truth. And so he led Philip. Peter to Cornelius in Acts chapter 10. Peter was at Joppa, and he was waiting for lunch, and he was hungry, and he went up on the rooftop and had a vision. You're probably acquainted with the story, so we won't even take time to read it. But he had a vision where a sheet was let down out of heaven with all kinds of four-footed beasts and animals. And he was hungry, so God said, Peter, get up. Here's your lunch. And Peter said, not so, Lord. These are unclean. These are not on the diet of a Jew. I can't eat this food. And he was probably wondering why that was happening. And the vision happened again. But anyway, God was using that, the Holy Spirit was using that vision to tell Peter it was going to be okay to go to the Gentiles, and that God was going to accept them. And so God used that, and then God told Peter that there would be some men coming, and he was to follow them. And sure enough, three men came and asked for Peter, and when they met him, they told him that they had been sent there by Cornelius, a Gentile, who wanted Peter to come and preach to them. And so he followed this man, went into the house of Cornelius. You know the story, remember the story. Cornelius had a house full of people gathered together. Peter preached to them. The Holy Spirit fell upon them. And God revealed through that move that the church was a universal institution. Wasn't just for the Jew, but it was for the Gentile. And so the Holy Spirit led Peter to the house of Cornelius through a vision, and God's work spread into the Gentile world. Paul, on his missionary journey in Acts chapter 16, it's okay to make plans when we're working for the Lord, but sometimes God interrupts those plans. And Paul tried to go into Bithynia, and the Spirit wouldn't let him, and so they were going to go somewhere else, and the Spirit said, no, I don't want you to go there. And so Paul went to bed frustrated that night, but during the night he had a vision, and there appeared unto him a man from Macedonia, and the man said, come over into Macedonia and help us. And so God used a dream or a vision to get Paul to go into Macedonia, which was a very important move for the church. It began to go west instead of east, and as you study church history, that was a very very significant move. And so Paul was led by the Holy Spirit to go into Macedonia, and he obeyed God, and because of that, the gospel went into the western part of the world. And so we're saying all this to say that Jesus told his disciples, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you. And they followed up on that. You can read it on throughout the sacred history, the book of Acts of the church. And even when you read secular history, you'll read how the Holy Spirit led and helped the people of the church to do and accomplish God's will. And as men and women obeyed the Spirit, the work of God advanced and went forward. And so the Holy Spirit has been given to you and to me to guide us into all truth and to help us on our way to heaven to walk in the will and the way of God. And sometimes the Holy Spirit may help us in rather insignificant decisions. And yet, maybe no decision is completely insignificant. But yet, when we come to major questions in our lives, the Holy Spirit can help us and to point out the direction that we are to go. Linda and I were living in the Virgin Islands in the 69 through 83. And we had just made a move from the American island of St. Thomas to the British island of Tortola. And the work was in some transition and some changes were about to be made. But anyway, about midnight, that's a poor time of the day to have to make decisions. But about midnight, we got a telephone call from the mission board here in the States. It was only about 10 o'clock their time, it was about midnight our time. And they were in a board meeting and they were discussing the work in the Virgin Islands and some changes that were going to be made. And so they told us over the phone, we're going to give you three choices. And we want you to call us back in 2 hours and tell us what you're going to do. And we're not at liberty to give you any details. Just A, B, or C. You talk about it, you pray about it, you call us back in 2 hours and give us your answer. Well, we climbed out of bed and began to pray and talk, and we looked at the three options they gave us and discussed them, and I won't take time to tell you what they were, but they involved a move back to the American Virgin Islands or to stay where we were. And we prayed about it and talked about it for a couple hours and finally decided on what we would felt like we ought to do. I called the board back and I said, well, we've spent a couple hours praying and talking about this, and this is what we feel like we ought to do. And Brother Burl Canahan, I was talking to on the phone, and he was so relieved. He said, that is exactly the answer we needed to hear. That is the only decision that will work in with something else that's working on. They couldn't tell us what was in the mix, but the answer we gave them was the exact answer they needed to help someone else get involved in the work and see the work go forward. And so that's not the only time. It was one of the spectacular times when we know that the Holy Spirit led us in the way that we should go. He will guide you into all truth. And no matter what the decision might be, it may look like a major one or even a minor one. When we're walking with God and want to follow God, and things will influence our walk with God, we have the Holy Spirit to help us and to guide us. Just as the pillar of fire led and guided the children of Israel, so the Holy Spirit will lead us and guide us. And I'm thankful for the leadership of the Holy Spirit many, many times. We're here today because we felt like the Holy Spirit directed us here. And so I'm thankful this morning for Jesus' promise that when He, the Spirit of truth, has come, He will guide you into all truth, and that you pertains to you today. And then we notice here in Exodus chapter 3, the fire and the cloud were Israel's for good as long as they were on their journey. Exodus chapter 13, verse 22, He took not away the pillar of the cloud by day, nor the pillar of fire by night from before the people. God put the fire and the cloud there, and He left it there until they got to the Holy Land, until they got to the Promised Land. The fire and the cloud were there to guide them and protect them until their journey was complete. And so God has given us the Holy Spirit to help us on our way to heaven, and He will be with us until we get there. Jesus said in John chapter 14, and verse 16, And I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another Comforter, that He may abide with you for a couple of years. You think that's the way that verse reads? No, that He may abide with you forever. The Holy Spirit is ours for good. As long as we are on our journey, just as Israel had the cloud by day and the fire by night to guard them and to guide them, We have the Holy Spirit in our life from our journey till we get to heaven to guard us and to guide us. So trust the Holy Spirit. Follow the Holy Spirit. He will lead you and he will guide you into all truth. Turn your dad to the Holy Spirit today, that he's ours personally, and that we can follow him and know that he's leading us in the right direction. So we need to, as we get going through this new year, to follow the Holy Spirit closely, pay attention to his directions, and he will lead us and guide us in the way that God wants us to go. Amen. Shall we stand? Yes, you'll have a good afternoon. Again, remember the Bible study at 5. Brother Carl, will you dismiss us, please?
Pretty heavy, Father, you come through this day to you, Lord, for your presence today. Thank you, Lord, for this visit, for thy blessing to go with us and make us a blessing today. We ask that you lead us in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.